By default, CoreData is not shared with your app's extensions. I will show you how to get it working for all of your projects. And speaking of projects, I actually made a free macOS and iOS app called LaunchBuddy to help you structure your app's releases and updates. So before we get started with how to share your CoreData stack with your app extension, let's first have a quick look at the demo project that I have prepared. It's a very simple iOS application. It just has a list here of all of the items. An item is my entity in CoreData. An item has a string, I called it text, and a date, which is just a timestamp of when it was created. And then in my content view, I just have a list of all these items showing the text and the timestamp. So nothing fancy whatsoever. And just to be clear, all of this data over here comes from our preview persistence controller. And the persistence controller is basically exactly the one that gets auto-generated when you select that CoreData checkbox when adding it to your when creating your project and adding CoreData to it. So I even left in all of these comments and fatal errors and so on that I would usually get rid of, just to make it easier to understand for you. So I have a preview controller here just generating some dummy data that's just used for our SwiftUI preview here. We can also have a look at the simulator. So there is a text field at the top and a save button. So in the text field, we can enter any string. So let's say item number one, hit save, and then it will get saved to CoreData and also displayed in the list here. And then there's also a widget, and the widget just shows how many items are currently saved in CoreData. And the widget shows zero because our CoreData stack is not connected from the app to our widget extension right now. Alright, so what I have in the widget extension, I basically just created a function to get all of my items from CoreData using the shared persistence controller. That works because for the persistence controller, I opened the navigator here and made sure that the target membership is both my main app and my widget extension. You will definitely have to do that for your persistence controller and also for your CoreData model. I already did this, but this is the first step that you will have to do to connect them. And then inside of my widget extension, I just get the data using a simple item.fetch request and then context.fetch that request. And then in our view, I just say entry.itemCount, and item count is just a count of all of the items that we have in CoreData. So super simple stuff. Really nothing fancy going on in the widget, but as you can see, the widget doesn't reflect the actual count of items in our CoreData stack. Now to get started, let's close everything here and just open up our persistence Swift file or our persistence controller. And let me first of all get rid of this huge comment here because it's just in our way. And the thing that we now need to set up is an app group. An app group is usually meant to link data or to share data between different apps by the same developer, but it can also be used to share data between apps and its extensions. So let's go into your Xcode project and select your main app target, go to signing in capabilities, and under capabilities, select app groups. Loading these app groups might take a few seconds, and then you can just hit plus and create a new app group. So I would recommend you to keep that group dot at the beginning and then just enter your bundle identifier. And then also make sure to copy that identifier so you can reuse the exact same one without making any typos later on. Hit OK. And then this will take a few seconds. Then you might have to refresh this list here. And now your app group is set up for your main app. Let's do the same in the widget extension now. So let's hit plus again, select app groups, and then you can just scroll down in your list of app groups. And with that, our app groups are set up. Next, as you might know, CoreData is basically just a wrapper about an SQLite database. And that database is really just a file stored on the user's device. Now, currently it's stored in a directory that's only accessible to the main app. And we want to now tell our persistence controller to store it at a place where the entire app group can access it. For that, let's first write a little convenience extension for URL so we can easily access that URL that we want. So let's say public extension on URL, and let's create a static func store URL for our app group, which is just a string, and a database name, which is also just a string, and this then returns a URL. So we will use the app group identifier, the database name, which is the name of your core data file, and then create or give us back the URL for that database. So in here we will say got let file container equals file manager dot default dot container URL for security application group identifier app group. If that fails, we will have to throw a fatal error because this is not a throwing function and it's also not an optional return type or a result return type. So we will just throw a fatal error, maybe add a little comment saying unable to create URL for, and then pass in that app group. And if we got that file container, we can just say return file container.appending path component, and this path component should be our database name dot SQLite. This is something that I basically copy over into every single one of my core data projects. I think I found this on Stack Overflow a few years ago, so just a very handy extension to use for app groups and core data. Next, let's actually use this. So we don't care about our preview up here, so let's collapse that real quick. What we care about is the initializer of our persistence controller. So right before we check whether it's the preview, basically, that's this if check here, we will have to grab our URL. So let's say let URL equal URL dot store URL for, and now this for here is our app group identifier, which you hopefully copied earlier. And then the database name is just the name of your database file. So in my case, my text storage. Next, we need to tell our persistent container to actually use this URL. So for that, we will create a persistent store description. So let's say let store description equal an NS persistent store description given this URL. And then we can say container.persistentStoreDescriptions equals this description right here. Then we can keep this if in memory check, and we can also keep this load persistent stores function. And with that set up, now let's run the app again on the simulator and see what changed. All right, so the first thing that you might notice is that our core data list is empty again, and this is a big issue. And that's why I recommend you to always start with an app group. No matter if you plan to add widgets or any kind of extensions, it's really better to just always start with an app group, start with this exact setup, and then you can add your widgets without losing any data or having to migrate any data. If you already have a core data stack and your app has already been used for quite a while and you now want to add widgets, you will have to manually migrate the data. So you will have to grab the data from your old SQLite file and put it into the new SQLite file. This is not part of this video, it's a bit too complex, but you can look that up yourself. That's why I recommend to always start with an app group for your app, even if you don't plan to add widgets in the near future. This is also helpful for intent extensions, for example. So now let's actually try out our implementation. So let's say this is my first text entry. Let's hit save. And it is saved indeed to our list. And going to the home screen now, you will see that the widget shows a 1, which is the count of items in our core data SQLite file or in our core data storage. I recommend you to subscribe to this channel if you want to learn more about core data, widget kit, and SwiftUI. And with that said, I will see you in the next one.